This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this service of worship this morning at Duke University Chapel. It is a joy to be with you all this morning as we watch and wait during this Advent season for the coming of our Lord. Today is your last chance to purchase animals from the Congregation Youth for Families in Need through Heifer International. Purchasing a cow for someone who needs it seems to be a better gift idea for someone who has all that she could ever want. So I encourage you to stop by the back if you have that special someone in your life who already has everything they want or need. This afternoon, the Choral Society of Durham, who is under the direction of Dr. Rodney Weinkoop, will be having their Christmas concert at 4 p.m. You can purchase tickets at the university box office or at the door. You'll not want to miss this. Our guest musicians this morning are the cantabile singers of the Capital City Girls Choir. It is a delight to have you all with us today. Thank you for being here. Please stand now to worship and praise the Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord's anointed comes to break oppression, set captives free, and take away transgression. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and each other, that we might experience this freedom. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you unto himself, cleanse you from your sins, and strengthen you to live in the power of the Holy Spirit all your days. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we experience the freedom of being forgiven by Christ, let us share signs and words of Christ's peace.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. God, for whom we watch and wait, you sent John the Baptist to prepare the way of your Son. Prepare us now as we hear your word. Give us courage to speak the truth, to hunger for justice, and to suffer for the cause of right. With Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah, the 35th chapter. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp, the grass shall become reeds and rushes. A highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Holy Way. The unclean shall not travel on it, but it shall be for God's people. No traveler, not even fools, shall go astray. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come upon it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. The gospel lesson is from Matthew, the 11th chapter. Dean Wells is preaching from this text. When John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me." As they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. "What did you go out into the wilderness to look at? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? Someone dressed in soft robes? Look, those who wear soft robes are in royal places. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, 'See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you.' Truly I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist, yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." This is the word of the Lord.
The living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Around 10 years ago, when I was the pastor of a neighborhood church in England, I got a call from a woman in distress. She said, "Pastor, my home is haunted. Can you come and do an exorcism?" Now, you may be aware that one thing I don't possess is adrenaline. I'm not the kind of pastor who gets a crisis call, jumps through the window of a waiting patrol car, starts up the siren and tosses a flashing light on the roof, and then heads into danger while a screech of tires announces lights, camera, ministry. But I try to take people seriously, maybe more seriously than they take themselves, especially when they're in distress. So a day or two later, I visited the woman and we sat together on the sofa as I explained that Jesus, in his death and resurrection, had overcome the power of evil and that the way we embody Jesus' victory is through baptism. But baptism doesn't always give us freedom from fear. So I was inviting her to join me as I visited each room in the house, sprinkled the waters of baptism, and prayed for deliverance from fear. And that's exactly what we did. 15 minutes later, when we'd entered and prayed and sprinkled in each room, we returned to the sofa in the sitting room. The woman looked at me with disappointment in her face. "Is that it?" she said. "I could have done that." She was a little bit more honest and direct than most of us. But my guess is almost everyone here will have felt like that about Christianity at some stage or other. What does it all amount to? A mysterious man long ago who did and said interesting things and got buried for it. A whole bunch of people trying to follow him or somehow use him as a route to immortality. And as often as not, falling out with each other or turning it all into a power grab or a form of imperialism or patriarchy or division. A story of aspiration, illusion, fragility, and failure. Maybe that's how you feel right now. Is that Christianity? Is that it? That's no big deal. I could have done that. I could have made that up easy. And the feelings multiplied and focused when you've actually given your life to it and put yourself in personal danger because of it. We all know that the cynic is the failed romantic. You don't hate if you haven't first loved. You don't feel let down if you weren't first built up. That's where John the Baptist got to. He'd proclaimed Jesus. He'd done the whole camel's hair coat and locusts and wild honey diet and call to repent thing. He'd thrown his entire life into preparing the way for Jesus. And now he'd been tossed into prison. And he finds himself thinking, "Jesus, are you for real? Is this it, or are we going to see some action? When do we get the baptizing with the Holy Spirit and unquenchable fire routine? Hey, bring it on. I don't want to be pushy, but really, now would be a great time." To put John's question into contemporary language, we might say, "Hey, Jesus, why are you hanging out with the people who don't matter and not being more strategic? It seems Pilate's still running Jerusalem, Herod's still in charge in his palace, and the Jewish authorities have still got the temple and the practice of the law all buttoned up. It feels like you haven't got the head or the heart for tackling the systemic issues. You've not even set foot in Jerusalem yet. Are you the one who is to come, or is it time we were looking for someone else?" It's important to feel the force of John's question. He's basically right. And for most of us, for most of the centuries that have followed, we've been wondering about the same things. When it comes to constructing a Messiah, Jesus just doesn't look the part. You can imagine John in the loneliness of his prison cell, pondering the shortcomings of Jesus. Jesus was from Nazareth. That's another name for nowhere. Jesus lived a humble life, and his disciples were a mixture of common people and formerly notorious sinners, hardly movers and shakers. Jesus was constantly in controversy and was destined for rejection and suffering. This isn't exactly baptizing with the Holy Spirit and unquenchable fire. Jesus looks and sounds too much like the ordinary, the mundane, the downright failure to be a Messiah. Are you John? Are you in a physical or mental or emotional place where the kingdom is very hard to see? Are you in prison right now? Do you feel duped, let down, disillusioned by Jesus? Have you lost the joy? Are you privately furious with Jesus because you believed he changed everything, but everything seems too much like it always was? Have you given your heart and soul to Jesus and now find yourself asking, "Are you the one that is to come, or should I be looking for someone else?" Listen to Jesus' answer. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, The deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. At first reading, it sounds like a catalogue of the kind of things we read in the Bible, and grabs our attention no more than a table attendant reeling off a list of the specials in a diner when we've been to the diner before, and we know the specials are always the same. But we need to look closely at each of these six statements. Jesus is announcing salvation in three dimensions. First, he's saying the salvation he's bringing reaches every aspect of human experience. It overcomes disability by addressing blindness and deafness. It overcomes sickness by cleansing leprosy. It overcomes alienation by bringing hope and joy to the poor. And it overcomes death by the power of resurrection. Jesus is gently saying to John, this may not be lightning and fire and revolution and judgment, but it's a comprehensive wave of healing on every level of existence. And healing is the heart of the kingdom. Second, Jesus offers a succinct summary of everything that has already taken place in the first 10 chapters of Matthew's gospel. The blind received their sight when Jesus touched the eyes of two blind men in chapter 9. The lame walked when Jesus both forgave the sins of the paralyzed man and told him to stand up earlier in chapter 9. The leper was cleansed when Jesus stretched out his hand and touched a kneeling leper in chapter 8. The deaf man was healed when Jesus cast out a demon again in chapter 9. The dead were raised when Jesus took the hand of the daughter of the leader of the synagogue, again in chapter 9. The poor had good news brought to them repeatedly, but most of all when Jesus began the Sermon on the Mount with the words, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus is gently saying to John, these are not just words, these are things I have already done. And third, Jesus refers John to the promises and hopes of Israel. His words echo several places in Isaiah, including chapters 26, 29, 42, and 61, but especially chapter 35, our Old Testament reading for today, made familiar by its role in Handel's Messiah. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. Jesus is gently saying to John, all the promises of the scriptures are finding their yes in me. And more than that, because added to Isaiah's hope are two new dimensions, the curing of the incurable illness of leprosy and the overcoming of the final enemy of death. Jesus' salvation is no letdown, no betrayal, no disillusioning anticlimax. It's comprehensive, already fully underway, and beyond hopes and expectations. But the trouble is, for John the Baptist, it still doesn't feel like it. Imagine an Englishman moving to North Carolina saying, I thought this was supposed to be the South, so why is it so cold then? Like the woman who asked me for a dramatic exorcism and said, I could have done that. John's not impressed. In the satirical Monty Python film Life of Brian, set in first century Judea, the opposition to the Romans is hopelessly split. The People's Front of Judea is at loggerheads with the Judean People's Front. The Judean Popular People's Front, the Campaign for a Free Galilee, and the Popular Front of Judea. One of these splinter groups has a secret meeting where a vigilante soldier asks, what have the Romans ever done for us? One by one, his fellow freedom fighters grudgingly acknowledge a host of benefits the Romans have indeed brought. But Reg, their leader, remains unconvinced. He finally demands, all right, but apart from better sanitation and medicine and education and irrigation, and public health, and roads, and a fresh water system, and baths, and public order, what have the Romans ever done for us? To which the reply comes, brought peace. Reg has no answer to that. And John the Baptist has no answer when Jesus describes what salvation means and how it has come with him. Around 15 years ago, I attended a conference about the renewal of the Christian faith. All the speakers came from big churches with famous ministries. Every one of them was miserable. They were full of complaints about what was wrong with the church and the world. All the speakers were cross with the world because it had strayed so far from the church. But when they spoke about the church, they seemed just as cross with that too. So the argument about the world needing to be more like the church didn't sound quite so convincing. And then, after four or five of these dismal addresses, one pastor got up and simply said, "I don't know about you guys, but at my church, we're having a great time. Strangers are finding faith. Relationships are being healed. People are dying in such a way that fills everyone with gratitude and the glory of God. Beautiful new friendships are being made. The Holy Spirit is surprising us, and Jesus just keeps showing up." And I thought, I want to be in his church. In fact, I want to believe in his God. He seems to be having all the fun. He doesn't seem to be anxiously counting numbers of members or size of endowment or targets for diversity. He seems to be enjoying the kingdom, whatever the outcomes. The other guys seem to be so caught up in believing exactly the right things and living totally unimpeachable lives and being righteously furious with all the bad people, they seem to have lost the joy altogether. I still want to be in that pastor's church. I want Duke Chapel to be like that. Sure, we all have wilderness times of heart or head. We all have John the Baptist times and the prisons of our own or others' making that make us wonder if Jesus is for real or if he was just a well-intentioned guy who got misunderstood. But those are the times we desperately need to look at our church, not to see perfect doctrine or squeaky clean ethics, but to see what Jesus described and what that pastor was enjoying. Strangers finding faith, relationships being healed, people dying in such a way that fills everyone with gratitude and the glory of God, beautiful new friendships being made, the Holy Spirit surprising us, and Jesus just keeping on showing up. Several years ago, about 9 months after I came to Duke Chapel, a worshiper who comes about once a month greeted me in the narthex. There's always a lot of people around after the Sunday worship service, and there's never time to say very much to each other. I often wonder if I've fully understood what someone's just told me, and whether they've actually had a chuckle in their cheek or a tear in their eye. This person simply took my hand, looked at me seriously, and said, "It's working." What did it mean? It was such an enigmatic remark. I pondered it for a long time. But then I thought about John's question to Jesus. Are you for real, or should we be expecting a different kind of kingdom? And I remembered that pastor years ago who was enjoying himself. I reflected on the life of Duke Chapel and thought, people are finding their voice in faith. People are forging unusual and brave friendships. People are facing their own powerlessness and being filled with the Holy Spirit to take risks of patience, courage, and hope. People are feeling their hearts on fire as the good news is sung and spoken and lived. People are meeting Christ in the stranger and entertaining angels unawares. Relationships are being healed and people are discovering ways to be with the poor and those of other faiths. It's working. This is for real. This is beautiful. This is joy. Jesus and John both knew they were going to be executed pretty soon. Neither was interested in an escapist, cotton wool gospel. But one of them saw through these circumstances to the vision of God. This sense of peace and beauty and joy isn't about material comfort or tangible success. It's about being in the groove of the Spirit It's about being with the grain of the saints. It's about consistently finding yourself where Jesus shows up. It's about knowing that wherever you are may not be classy, may not be prestigious, may not be noticed by the great and the good, may have no relation to paid employment or career prospects or a sense of achievement. But it's something much deeper, much more important, much more permanent. And that's dancing in the rhythm of the kingdom, singing the song in God's heart, glimpsing the dawn of salvation, breathing in the glory of God's art. Can you see that beauty? Can you feel the peace and purpose of Christ's coming kingdom? If you can, then others will see you as I saw that pastor all those years ago and rediscover the joy. They'll feel their heart lighter than before and sense their lungs filling with hope. And they'll turn to one another and whisper quietly but confidently, "It's working."
It's been a season of sadness in the congregation as we've had two deaths recently. As we lift our prayers to God this morning, we remember the families of Ben Covington and Dale Files, and we hold in our hearts all who are grieving the loss of loved ones during these holy days. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God, who walks among us, the promises of the scripture find their yes in you. Open our eyes to see that yes in our midst. Give all people the wisdom to recognize you in the humble, the quiet, and the inconspicuous. Touch our hearts when we feel alienated, and encourage your faithful to be strong and not to be afraid.
Help everyone gathered here today to know that it is working, that you are working in their lives. Impress us with your promised kingdom and inspire your servants to give both heart and soul to you. Keep showing up and surprising those who seek you with your real presence. Lord, in your mercy. God of salvation, healing is at the heart of your kingdom. Your prophet Isaiah assured that you would strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Quicken our steps and gladden our hearts so that we may leap and dance in praise of you. Heal your people, we pray, so that in you all may overcome disability, sickness, and death. We give you thanks for those in our local community with different physical and mental abilities. Teach us strength and perseverance through their successes, and accompany caregivers who help to improve their quality of life. Cause all sorrows and sighings to flee away, and grant your people the joy that comes from trust in you. Lord, in your mercy. God of all freedom, you have come to liberate the captive. Free us from the prisons that we inhabit. As you did with your servant John, send word of your life-giving works. Share your good news and invite all people into your new creation. In a moment of silence, we remember those who are returning home after time spent in jail. Provide welcoming and supportive communities. Open up meaningful employment. Make educational opportunities available, and restore civil liberties for those struggling with reentry. This winter, warm the hearts and bodies of anyone who is numb and cold, especially those impacted by snowstorms in Europe and the Midwest. Give shelter to the homeless and a hearth to the dispossessed. Lord, in your mercy. Prepare a place in our hearts for you, O God, and shine your holy light on us so that we may know you when you come to us as infant, Christ, and King. Amen. And now let us offer our gifts to God through this week's tithes and offerings. Thank you.
If you are here today with a care or concern for someone or something that is dear to you, ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right. They are eager to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel, for you have opened the eyes of the blind and unstopped the ears of the deaf. You have made the lame leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. You made this world as a playground of delights, and you called a people to be your companions forever. In Jesus, you showed us who you are, who we are, how far we have strayed from you, and how to become your companions again. And so our souls magnify you, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. Jesus, you fill the hungry with good things. You show mercy from generation to generation. You show us the cost and glory of your salvation in the breaking and pouring and sharing of bread and wine. Send down your Holy Spirit, that your people may be sanctified by your grace, and these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup also, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Delivering God, we call on you to fulfill your Advent promise. May waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. Make a highway on which no traveler, not even fools, shall go astray. Bring home those who are in exile. Fill their hearts with singing and shower their heads with everlasting joy. Unite your church. Clothe us with the fruits of your Spirit, and fill us with the hope of Advent, the substance of things hoped for, and the knowledge of things unseen, until all bow before your throne and worship in your glory, ever one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. In the broken bread of Christ's body, we encounter the one who is to come. Our Advent hope is alive when we feast at this table. Come experience the joy of the Lord.
Thank you.
Please stand. Almighty God, in our waiting, you have revealed yourself. We give you thanks for the good news proclaimed in the gift of your broken body and shed blood. Open our eyes and ears that through your works we might know that we wait for no other. We thank you for the Religious Studies Department and its role in educating students about the religious lives of cultures near and far. Bless its efforts to encourage respect and appreciation across religions. We rejoice in the agencies in Durham who strive for the health and well-being of all the members of our community. Use our gifts this morning to support and encourage them. Make us a people blessed by what we see and hear of your gospel at work in the world, and fortify us in the power of your love that we might not take offense at you. Give us confidence to know that you are the one who has come and who is to come, so we might testify to your presence in the world with joy. Amen. May you find the Spirit alive and the gospel working as you await the coming of the Lord. And may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.